After that, there were two concepts. So last class we were discussing about the accuracy and precision, and so all of you are hearing me? Hello, online?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So last class, if I remember correctly, we completed this portion. Yes or no?
We completed this.
Yes, sir. Okay.
So after
this, yes, sir.
We are supposed to understand the under concept. There are two concepts regarding the precision we should understand. First one I told you already, all precise measurement may not lead to accurate values, okay, but all accurate results require precise measurement, fine. And I told you with the simple Gunshot experiments, general example. After that we discussed this one also, one numerical example. So the first guy is more accurate, but means analyst 1 is more accurate, but analyst 2 is more precise. Even though he is precise, but he could not reach the accurate results. So that again the same concept, it is not necessary that if your values are precise you should get an accurate result, okay. Maybe a particular problem could be present in all your measurements, okay, right. Now I think I told you one more thing. For comparison purpose, we should use relative error for the accuracy, and for the precision, we should use relative standard deviation. That is the best one. Relative standard deviation and relative error for comparison purpose, that is better. That is fine. In addition, there was a term average deviation. Okay. Average deviation is not a very good term for comparison, okay, because if you see here in this case, okay, the average deviation is summation of deviations divided by number of experiments. So summation of deviations, this is a single deviation, one is minus 0.02, second one is plus, and 3 and 4 are 0.00. So here the average deviation comes as 0, but we really have some deviation, okay. That's why we should not use average deviation. But to avoid this one, some book they follow just removing the minus sign, okay. Just they remove the magnitude of the sorry remove the minus they use the magnitude, but that is not so correct, okay. So we will not use average deviation for comparison purpose. So this concept is over. I think I completed at this point. Yes. So next one is that very similar one regarding the accuracy and precision. So you can read it. Increasing the number of experiments may improve the accuracy and the precision of the measurement. I mentioned it may improve. It is not necessary that it must improve. It may improve. What is the meaning? I can tell you. So for example, first time you take one and the first time you are doing some four analysis. Let us say you are determining the mercury present in a catalyst, and you are doing four analysis, and then you calculate the accuracy and precision, right? And then continue for another three measurements, means another three results, seven results. Now again make the accuracy and precision. Then what is happening? By that way we can understand if we are increasing the number of experiments, whether it is going to increase the accuracy and the precision, okay. So the same example I am giving. First of all, you see that the accepted value measurement is 4.2 microgram per gram. So you see it is microgram per gram. How at any point, at which point you can use this kind of unit it is not actually unit, it is simply a parts. Can you guess? You see, I am writing 4.2 microgram per gram. What is the meaning? It is also gram, it is also gram. Yes, so it is, in this case not exactly mercury. So generally, one example we can take, suppose I am writing 4.2 microgram per gram. So 4.2 microgram is present in 1 gram of the given substance. Particular component is present, 4.2 microgram in the whole 1 gram. Okay, so first case, we are doing the analysis 4 times, okay, up to here, 3.2 microgram you are getting, okay. Then in the second, see, after that, you are trying to calculate the precision and accuracy, and then you are continuing for the 3 more experiment. So up to here, it is the same. It is the same like here, you completed the 4 experiments, and after that, you are running 3 more experiments. Then you are doing the same analysis, means accuracy and precision. To say a particular reading is precise, you have to calculate any one precision parameter. To say a particular set of values are accurate, you should calculate any one accuracy parameter. So normally I told you, for comparison purpose, relative error in the case of accuracy, relative standard deviation in the case of precision is important. Okay, it is better. Now we are calculating the relative error for accuracy and relative standard deviation for the precision. So you can see relative error is 7.1 gram and relative standard deviation is 12.3 gram in the case of instruments. If you stop your experiment at the first 4 points, then this is the case. Now you increased 3 more experiments and these are the 3 more results. Now you are calculating the accuracy and precision for the 7 set of measurements. So I think I don't need to explain this one again, how we calculated the absolute error. E is equal to, what is this 3.9? Yeah, this is the measured value. From measured value, from where you are getting? We are having 4 results. But the measured value, we are writing 3.9. What is that? Mean. So in any set, 4 set of measurement, value, final value. You cannot use each time one result, okay? You should use only one value as your final result. So a final result, most of the time, mean. Okay, so mean we have taken, and this is the absolute error and relative error. Relative error don't have sign, but absolute error will have sign also and the unit also. Relative error will not have sign most of the time, but if you want, you can put it, okay? And it is always expressed in terms of percentage. So the same way we are calculating here, relative error comes 4.8%. And relative standard deviation comes 9%. Now you can understand. See, RSD is high here. Relative standard deviation is high. It means it is less precise. You understand? Deviation is high, so it is less precise. And in this case, deviation is less when you compare to this one, right? So it is more precise than this one. So precision is increased. When you do the 3 additional experiment, the precision is increased. And when you do the additional experiment, 3 experiment, what about the accuracy? Accuracy also increased because it is having less relative error compared to this one. So the point is again, increasing the number of experiments may improve the accuracy and precision, but it is not necessary always. Okay, maybe at the third, on the 3 results, you may have some problem. So you may get some additional error. So it sometimes it may lead to not improve in accuracy, maybe at least similar, sometimes may decrease also, but they are rare. Okay, so if you are doing the experiment carefully, you must get improved accuracy and improved precision. Okay, this is about the accuracy and precision. Now this is for some others, not for you. Okay, so this portion, I completed some portion. So I will send you this one, maybe in the next class. Or after this is class is over, I can circulate this PDF file. So now we are going to the another topic. ओके अनदर टॉपिक यू कैन सी यस डिटरमिनेट एंड इनडिटरमिनेट एरर सो वी अंडरस्टैंड दैट हाउ टू डिजाइन एन एक्सपेरिमेंट ओके फ्रॉम द बिगिनिंग डेफिनेशन ऑफ द प्रॉब्लम एंड सेलेक्ट द एप्रोप्रिएट मेथड and get the representative sample like that we did the analysis and we reported only one value that is mean value that is fine after that we understand what is accuracy and what is precision so how your values are deviating from the accepted value or how your values are very close to each other in the precision we all these things we understand but only very very important point we should understand always we are having deviation okay exactly it is not going to be same value on your repeated analysis why this is happening okay so if you are doing 10 analysis all the 10 analysis is not going to be constant even though all the things you are following similarly okay same titration same procedure same volume same sample but still you are getting some other different value so why it is happening okay or how we can classify that is known as determinant and indeterminate errors okay. so and from now itself we understand that errors are inevitable means it must be always present in our measurement that we understand so how to classify this error or how it is occurring and further how it is if possible these things we have to see that is based on the occurrence or based on the nature of the error we can classify the error into determinate and indeterminate error okay but don't confuse this term with the accuracy parameter that is absolute error and relative error they are different here based on the occurrence how it occurs based on the nature of the and nature of the error we are classifying the error into two broad category that is determinate error and indeterminate error this determinate error is having synonymous see determinate error and systematic error are same if I say determinate error that has another name systematic error okay so systematic error and determinate error are same and indeterminate error random error accidental error are all same okay only two type of error we are classifying one is determinate and another one is indeterminate and another name for determinate error is systematic error another name for indeterminate error is random error and accidental error okay accidental error let us go to understand what is determinate so from the name itself you can understand you can have a definite reason okay for the determinate error and you can determine the amount the value you can determine it so these are the four points determinate errors have definite values that's why we say determinate error and they have assignable cause it means you can understand why it has appeared after the analysis over if you are thinking or if you are trying to verify this one you can understand why it could have appeared this error okay this is not some reason that's why it is assignable cause and they are unidirectional I will come to this point after this one they are under the control of the experimenter determinate error you can control means if you are doing carefully you will get less error less determinate error if you are doing carelessly if you are not following the procedure then you will get high error that is determinate error but there are some other error indeterminate error even though whatever you are careful whatever procedure is exactly followed you will get some error that is indeterminate error so this error under the control of the experimenter that is can be mainly gained when you are doing repeated experiment if you can also definitely remember when you are doing the titration very beginning you must be having large error and next time the errors are going getting decreasing okay so that is you can gain by experience that error is known as systematic error and they are unidirectional now particular error
can cause a particular deviation. Okay, a particular type of error cannot cause positive deviation and negative deviation also cannot cause. Okay, suppose I am having first of all assume that you are preparing a standard solution, standard magnesium solution, and 100 ml solution you prepared today, and of course you safely it properly and then kept it by mistake or for some reason you kept it open. Okay, you kept it open and you went means the class is over, let us assume like that, and next week the class is started, but you are going to use the same solution. So what will happen, since you left it open, so some amount of solvent must have evaporated. So it is not exactly 100 ml, it may be 95 ml or something, let us say 95 ml, 5 ml is evaporated after a week. Now concentration of that solution will increase or decrease? Concentration, mole, capital M. Increase or decrease? Tell me. Increase or decrease? Increase or decrease? Concentration will decrease. Tell me. Increase. It is obvious. It will increase. See, it will increase. Okay. Year you prepared the magnesium solution in 100 ml. Now assume that you prepared the same magnesium solution only in 95 ml. So it means same amount of magnesium is there. Assume that the same amount of magnesium you are dissolving in 100 ml and same amount of magnesium you are dissolving in 95 ml. Which one will have high concentration? That is the reason. Okay, so 5 ml is evaporated. So it become concentrated. So this kind of error, you are leaving it accidentally or due to evaporation of the solvent. So in the case of water, it is fine. But in the case of non-aqueous solvent like dichloromethane, acetonitrile, if you are keeping it open, it may immediately, within 5 minutes, the volume may decrease, acetone, all those things. So this kind of error will always cause a increase in concentration. It is never going to give you a decrease in concentration. Okay, so this is called unidirection, right? This error can cause always a positive deviation, means increase in concentration. That's why we say unidirectional. And then of course I will tell you one more example later. Now come to the indeterminate error. This nature of the indeterminate error more or less opposite to the determinate error. Okay, but don't write like this. Define different determinate error and indeterminate error opposite to determinate error. Don't write like that. Understand? You should say what is it. But more or less they are opposite to determinate error. First of all, these errors arise due to random fluctuations in procedures and measuring devices. Suppose you are measuring a pH meter. Suppose you are measuring absorbance, unknown reason, it is your control. Due to some reason, means maybe in all instrument we have so many small components like a small condenser, small resistance, all those we have. SN junction, PN junction we have. So in that case, internal circuit may get heat. Because of that, your response may be affected, right? But how it will be affected, that is really not known. It is not reproducible, okay? If some error is occurring, indeterminate error, next time also same error should occur, it is not the case, okay? It may occur in different, that's why it is random fluctuations in procedures and measuring devices. And they have no specific cause. You cannot find what was the reason. Okay, you cannot assign some reason for this kind of errors, and they are bidirectional. I will tell you later. Okay, they are beyond the control of the experiment. Obviously, instrumental response, not only instrumental response, in the measuring devices also. Even if you are using burette pipette also, some device we are using, burette and pipette, okay,
they can give some flux results, okay, right? But most of the time it represents the power flux vessels instrumentation, okay, right? So, and what is, they are bidirectional. It means a particular type of error may sometimes cause a positive deviation, sometimes may cause a negative deviation. Okay, this is known as bidirectional. This point may be right now not clear. Okay, maybe some of you could understand, but many of you cannot understand how a particular error can cause positive or negative. So that we will discuss when we go to the normal error curve. Right now, just understand that they are bidirectional. Okay, but unidirectional, I explained to you. A particular error can cause deviation, right? It cannot cause both deviation. Yes. You see, loss of precipitate, another example for the determinate error to say unidirectional. Loss of precipitate in a gravimetry experiment. Again, listen to me. So, in a gravimetry experiment, okay, in a gravimetry experiment, what is gravimetry? First of all, precipitating and weighing procedure is known as gravimetry. Suppose you want to determine chloride ion, you are adding silver nitrate, silver chloride is formed, and you are collecting all the precipitate, and you are then take the weight of the precipitate only, then calculate the amount of chloride ion present. Okay, precipitation and weighing procedure. In this case, some error will happen. It is always possible that not all the precipitate can be collected. Some precipitate may be sticking on the beaker, okay, some precipitate may be sticking on the filter paper, maybe, right? Like that, you may lose definitely some amount of precipitate. So loss of precipitate, because of the loss of precipitate, you will get less concentration, yes? So loss of precipitate will never increase the result, okay? You understand? Some precipitate, and because of this loss, because of this particular error, you will not get increased value, you will get always decreased value. So this is known as unidirectional. This cannot cause two direction, but there are some errors which can cause both direction, okay? So, and now again, this determinate error can be classified into two different or three different categories. First one is instrumental error, second one is operative error, and methodic error. Instrumental error. So remember, I told you about the indeterminate error. So don't confuse that one. That is random fluctuations in the either instrument or in the measurement procedures. But instrumental error is different. If you are using a faulty equipment, then that is known as instrumental. Suppose you are using a 2 ml pipette. It is not exactly 2 ml, it may be 2.1 ml, then that is instrumental error. Pipette you can consider as an instrument, right? So similarly, you are measuring the pH of your solution, and the pH meter always shows some positive value, then that is instrumental error. So use of faulty equipments, okay, like anything, absorbance you are using, it is not properly calibrated, so it is always giving some positive absorbance. Then that is instrumental error. That comes under systematic error. You can correct it. Once you calibrate it, it may be corrected. Yes. So it is under the control of the experimenter. That's why instrumental error. But the random fluctuations, what I told in the indeterminate error, you cannot do anything. So that is indeterminate error. So don't confuse with that one. And then the operative error. Most of the time we have the operative error only. Most of the time, right? So it is due to the inexperience, right? So probably in the very beginning, when you make up the solution, so usually we give you some achar. Usually we ask you to prepare standard solution by weighing the some amount of magnesium. I don't know you have done it or not. So you are supposed to take the weight, some 0.2 gram of magnesium, and dissolve it in water in 100 ml. So what? If you have done, you must be remembering, you may lose some amount of, means some of the salt while transferring to the standard measuring flask. You are taking the weight in the weighing box, in the weighing machine, then you are taking the paper, and we used to expect you to keep your standard measuring flask nearby, so that you take it and transfer it. But most of the time you don't do it. What you do, you take the paper and go there, go up to there. Then there is a possibility of loss of precipitate. So there is a error in experience. Next time you understand. So we should not do. Similarly, once you prepared the transferred the salt, you are adding water. Okay, you are dissolving it, and you are supposed to add water up to the mark only. But because of the inexperience again, you may add water. It may go above. And what you do, you take a pipette and remove it, and the pipette is already contaminated. So that kind of error, that is because of the inexperience. So this kind of error can be removed by experience. So there are some other examples also I have given. Transfer of solutions, that's what I told you, yes. And effervescence and bumping during the sample dissolution. Some samples may be necessary to dissolve it, okay, and heat it also. In that case, there may be bumping. Because of bumping, some solution may spill out. That also can create some error. And incomplete drying of samples. Yeah. Bumping means when you are boiling a solution, some bumping can occur. Na? Bumping means sudden boiling. Okay. To avoid that one, you are supposed to add some porcelain bits. Some bits you have to add. So then this kind of bumping will not occur, but only the boiling will occur. Okay, porcelain bits, you understand, na? Something to create some.
Yeah. Like the bubble formation. Bubble formation at the time of boiling.
Sorry.
The bumping is like the bubble formation at the time of boiling.
Yes, bubble formation, if it is regular, but all on a sudden, if bubble is forming, then it will bump like a blast. Okay, that is called bumping. Okay,
yes,
if small bubbles are forming and continuously coming up, it is fine. So to create small bubbles and continuous bubbling, you should add some kind of small bits, porcelain bits, you know, porcelain. You can add something, or you should at least put a glass rod, so that is some air gap will come, some small vibrations can be get, and the effervescence will be, or the boiling will be equal. Okay, right. So this is about the up and methodic error. The third one is methodic error. Suppose if you are having impurities, and if you are not following the buffer. If buffer, you are supposed to use in the pH 9 buffer, but by mistake you are using pH 8 buffer, or you are not at all using buffer. These are all methodic error. And co-precipitation, probably you will study with Dr. MKP, you will be studying. You are supposed to precipitate, for example, chloride ion only. But if you are preparing, if you are precipitating in addition to chloride ion, bromide ion also, then that is impurity. You are precipitating impurity all like that. And when you are precipitating all on a sudden, means bulk precipitation, when you add a reagent fully, right, assume that you are having chloride solution, Cl minus ions, and you are adding silver nitrate concentrated one all on a sudden, then there could be possibility that some other soluble impurity also can be precipitated together with the silver chloride. It may be not possible to remove. Okay, so these are all co-precipitation of impurities. And in the case of again gravimetry, you are precipitating some material, okay, some compound. If that is soluble solvent, if it is soluble, then you will not get all the precipitate, then you will get your error. So that is slight solubility of precipitate and side reactions. We assume that silver plus and Cl minus ion gives you chloride only. Suppose there are some side reactions. It is simple reaction, it will be 100%. Okay. But there are some side reactions in organic reactions, you may get some other product. So in that case, you will not get correct results. And incomplete reactions. Okay. All are examples. All are examples for the methodic error. All three errors are known as, again, systematic errors only, right? This definitely you can rectify. Especially this operative error, you can rectify by experience. Okay. usually I used to draw a graph that is, I'm not sure, I don't have here, but that is known as learning curve. Learning curve, have you heard? Okay, I am, for the sake of the other students also, I am going to draw here the learning curve. Just to try to understand, I can draw it on board, but for the others also, see. Suppose in the y-axis, take, assume that it is a straight line, okay, y-axis. And this is the x-axis. It is a x-axis, right? In the x-axis, you are going to take number of experiments. Follow, in the x-axis, I am not writing, number of experiments, okay? And in the y-axis, it is going to be your skill. Or what you can say, okay, let us say your skill. Okay, in the y-axis your skill, and in the x-axis number of experiment. Now you can write in your paper and show me what will be the graph with the number of experiments. First number, so let us say that is skill at this point zero. You are having no skill, okay, at this point. Means y-axis I am putting zero skill here, and let us say that this is the 100% skill. Okay, you are having 100% skill here. Okay, when will you 100% skill? So just curve, how it will looks like, and you tell me. I'm just saying for the time being, I'm making it up, and then at least we have some rule so that why it is not going. Okay, so learning curve is, of course, it is not very important, but I tried to, so I must complete it. Okay. Learning curve, we are taking skill and number of experiments. So number of experiment, let us say first time number, and here it is 0 and here it is 100% skill, and 0 to number 1, number 10, number 20, number 40, it could be like that, number is 21, increasing. And in this case, your skill is 21 increasing. Now, Radhika, all of you, and comments, how it will be with the number of experiments? If anybody draw the zoom, this is the view. You will be the target of the okay, yeah. Thank you. What about the target? Okay, learning curve. Suppose you see this is a, it is just for your understanding, okay, not you don't need to call that, but understand it. You cannot start from zero. Definitely, whatever you have something, in the first experiment, you will have some skill, let us say 50, okay. And you will reach maybe 95, you will get the number of experiments, 10 experiments, you can reach 95. If you are really right. But after that, reaching 100 will be very difficult. Okay. okay, then this will be going on like this. And maybe not possible to reach 100%, or maybe at an infinity number of experiments. Okay, but you may reach very close to 100%. Okay, so this is known as learning. This is known as learning curve. Okay, so systematic error will decrease by experience, and that is the learning curve. Just I am showing here. You see, you are going to start here. And up to 95% or 90%, you may start very quickly, you may learn quickly, but reaching 100% may be difficult. It will be going on like this. Okay, right. So this is the learning curve, it is fine. Now, coming back to our discussion, I think I delete it. Okay, coming back to our discussion, let us see. So we classified systematic error and determinate error by the nature of the error. Okay, I will put this one also. Now we will go to CD. Now we will see you can classify the error into two different ways. You can classify the errors into two categories, that is constant error and proportionate error. Constant error, the value of the error will be constant irrespective of the sample size. What is sample size? Your sample volume or weight of the sample is sample size. Suppose you are doing analysis with 10 milligram of the sample, your sample size is 10 milligram. Suppose you are doing the analysis with the 20 milligram of the sample, your sample size is increased. Okay, so 5 ml of solution titration and 10 ml of the solution and having titration. Okay, so color is the error which will be present constantly. This amount will not change with the sample size. Suppose you are taking 5 ml of the solution and doing the titration, you may get how much error? You tell me. Your pipette solution is 5 ml, right? You have taken 5 ml of the solution and you added whatever necessary, like buffer, indicator, you added, right? Now you are doing the titration. So probably one or two drops will be the error, yes? Not more than that. See, this one or two drops, we can say 0.1 ml, right? So you 5 ml of a solution and doing the titration, you may get a 0.1 ml error. Do you agree or not? All of you. Yes? Now, in the another experiment, you are taking 10 ml of the solution, same solution, right? Doing the titration, right? Now, how much error you will get? 0.1 only. What about you? Less than 0.1. Same, you will get. This is known as constant error. But the magnitude will be different. That will become degrees. That I will tell you later. Okay. So, if you are taking 5 ml of, also you will get the same error. And if you are taking 10 ml of the solution also, you will get the same error. Means absolute value is same. Okay. So, this kind of error is known as constant error. Right. But there are some errors are there. With the size of the sample, the error will also increase. Like example I have given already, impurities in the reagent. Suppose you can take the same example, simple example. You are precipitating chloride ion as silver chloride by adding silver nitrate, right? Silver nitrate, you are assuming that it is 100%, it is pure. Suppose, right? Suppose it consists of only 90% pure, remaining 10% some other solution, actually or something which cannot precipitate. Now to precipitate, for example, 5 ml of the sample, 5 ml of the chloride ion sample, right? You may require 5 ml of the silver nitrate solution, right?
to completely precipitate a particular sample, 5 ml of the sample, assume that you need 5 ml of silver nitrate. Suppose if you are using here impure silver nitrate solution, which is only 90%, you need to add some more amount of silver nitrate to precipitate it completely. So now you are increasing the size of the sample. Like earlier you have taken 5 ml and you try to precipitate all the chloride ions, and now you are taking 10 ml and you are trying to precipitate all the chloride ions. Definitely you need to increase the amount of silver nitrate also. So again it is having error. So the same error means it is having impurity. That's why the same error will go on increasing depending upon the size of the sample. Okay, this is known as proportionate. And there are some advantages with the constant error. This is because it will be persistent. Constant error is going to be present in the measurement, and proportionate error will increase or decrease based on the sample size. So I think this one is not here, but regarding this, I may go to at the end also. I can show you what I want to say about the constant error. You see, we have discussed about the constant error. We will discuss this one in some other part, but right now something. Constant error, you are having 50 milligram of the sample always, okay, irrespective of the sample size. Constant error means it will be constant irrespective of the sample size, but proportionate error will increase proportionately with the sample size. This is the example. But to decrease, this is actually in another aspect, but if you are having a constant error and you want to decrease the magnitude of the error, you can increase the size of the sample. Okay, so that's what you told, this will decrease. See, 5 titration you are using, you are getting 0.1 ml error, right? Now you are using 10 ml, you are going to get the same 0.1 ml error only. Okay, it is not going to increase proportionately, right? Now you are taking 50 ml of the solution and doing the titration, again you will get only 0.1 ml error. Now what is the relative error? Relatively, see, earlier you got 0.1 ml error for 5 ml, yes, and you increase the size of the sample, you are getting the same error, that is 0.1 ml for the 50 ml. So the magnitude of the error is decreasing. So if you see the relative error, it will be very less. So that's the point. We will, of course, we will see it in a later stage, but you can see one example. Suppose you are doing the cryometric experiment, you are supposed to lose some amount of precipitate in all cases, right? Suppose you are losing 0.5 milligram of the precipitate in the total size of the sample, let us say 50 milligram. Okay, your whole precipitate is 50 milligram. During the collection and the weighing procedure, you are losing 0.5 milligram. Then what will be the error? The error 0.5 only you are losing among the 50 milligram. So the error, relative error, will be 1%. You agree? But the same amount if you are losing, that is 0.50 milligram, you are losing from 500 milligram. Because the process is same, you are going to lose only 0.5 milligram. In any process, if the sample is 500 milligram also, you will lose 0.5 milligram. If it is 50 milligram also, you will lose only 0.5. Like our titration, you will have 0.1 ml error irrespective of the sample size. Here also the same. So 1%, right? In this case, you are losing, total is 500. From the 500, you are losing 0.5 milligram. So the error is 0.5 relative error. So constant error will be present constant, the amount will be constant, but if you are increasing the size of the sample, the relative error will decrease. Okay, so that we can, suppose you want to decrease the magnitude of the error, then you can increase the sample size. That's why that is the difference between doing the titration of 1 ml and doing the titration of 10 ml. Okay, 1 ml also you are going to have 0.1 ml error,
10 ml also you will get 0.1 ml error only, but that error will be, relative error will be less. Okay, so this point we will discuss in some other point, aspect later, moving further our classification and all. Okay, so the next point is the same only. Now the next point is that methods to minimize the magnitude of the determinate error. So after completing this, we will go to the indeterminate error again, right? So methods to minimize the magnitude of systematic error. So in the very beginning I told you determinate error is under the control of the experimenter. You can control it. So how you can control, or how you can minimize the magnitude of error, that we are going to see. The very first one is calibration of apparatus. Like I told you, you are using 2 ml pipet, okay, you are taking a pipet, 2 ml full pipet, right? But if it is not exactly calibrated, it may be 2.1 ml or 1.9 ml, okay. So in that case, definitely you will have error. So you should calibrate it, not only glassware, maybe instrument, pH meter, absorbance, all those things should be calibrated properly. Probably we will discuss these things. We have 5 minutes, so I am stopping at this point. We will discuss this one in the next class. Let us ask something from the online students. Those, if you want. Yeah, any questions, sir? I am going to stop the, at this point. Okay, for the attendance purpose, those who are online, so here I will collect the name, but those who are online, you can answer the question like, what is constant error? Okay, submit it to wellganesh@yahoo.com. Now it means you are having 5 minutes, exactly you are having 5 minutes. You can submit it and then get ready for the next class. Probably next class will also take another 5 minutes. Okay, all of you understand? Say something.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Okay, great. Aditya Narayan. Aditya?
Yes, sir.
You understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Aisha? Aisha?
Yes, sir.
It's fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, if you have questions, you can ask me. Otherwise, you may leave. You may submit the assignment and leave. Yes, if you have questions.
Sir, please, can you show the assignment question again? Hello, sir. Hello, sir.
So this whole thing of the problem, standard deviation, Yes, you guys can discuss the rules.